25,000 vessels nearly pass through Istanbul Strait, and 18% of them, it makes approximately 10,000, are dangerous cargo-carrying tankers. On the other hand, the negative effect of global crisis can be easily seen on the passage figures in the year of 2009. There is significant decrement on these years. When it is looked from meteorological perspective, the Istanbul Strait is heavily influenced by strong winds, rain, and intensive fog, particularly during spring and autumn seasons. Furthermore, weather conditions may change rapidly so that a ship begins its passage in cloudy weather can find itself all of a sudden inside of the thick fog near zero visibility, like this. Besides these navigational difficulties, the age of ships which use the Turkish Straits are very high, and number of failures in the Istanbul Strait reflects this situation and technical standards of the vessel as well. This graph shows failures in the Istanbul Strait. Vessel failures increased year by year and reached up to 223 last year, whereas it was 126 in 2004. These failures were engine, rudder, gyro, and other failures such as important navigational equipment or auxiliary systems. In addition to ETS, the use of a pilot during passage provides another important means for enhancing the safety of navigation. Although using a pilot in the Turkish Straits is strongly recommended, the percentage of vessels using a pilot is only 48% for all vessels in the Istanbul Strait in 2009. If you go back to our scheme again, in the Turkish Straits, structural and non-structural mitigative measures are taken as a part of risk management. The Turkish Straits VTS and ATON are examples of structural measures, and there are some non-structurals like Turkish Maritime Regulations and TSS. If we look at the Turkish Straits VTS, there are currently two VTS sub-areas in the Turkish Straits, Istanbul VTS area and Çanakkale VTS area. Total distance of TSVTS area is 204 nautical miles. TSVTS began to operate at the end of 2003 and does not only enhance the safety of navigation, but it also performs an important contribution to the emergency response teams in case of an emergency situation. The TSVTS also assesses the risk by using information received from various sources. If I give an example to non-structural measures in the Turkish Straits, distance between two vessels at least 8 cables, speed limit is 10 knots, and overtaking a vessel is not allowed without permission of VTS. Even taking all of the above mentioned safety precautions, one cannot say that the risk of an accident in the Turkish Straits would be completely removed. The aim is to minimize all possible risks by taking all necessary measures. One of the greatest problems that vessels face arises from the use of unqualified crew, as well as the lack of adequate technical maintenance of the vessels. In the action plan phase, numbers of emergency action plans were developed for the Turkish states for the possible emergency situations, such as fire explosion, collision, grounding, elision, person overboard, sinking, medical assistance, flooding. It's very important that to master the situation accurately, to put the action plans into service as soon as possible. This is only possible if you get the information about emergency situation quickly and truly. This is motor tanker Nasya and motor vessel ship broker accident in the Istanbul Strait in 1994. In this accident, 29 crew members lost their lives and 20,000 tons oil spill occurred. Also, Istanbul Strait closed to vessel traffic for 1 week. Fortunately, we don't have such an accident after VTS established. In the Turkish Strait VTS, for each emergency situation, an emergency checklist is prepared in forms. And beside which measures should be taken, also which questions are going to be asked by the VTS operator or supervisor are defined clearly in these forms. As an example to implementation of emergency procedures, let's assume that a vessel ran aground or two vessels collided in the Istanbul Strait, although all measures have been taken. First of all, VTS operator informs all vessels within the sector in accordance with the procedures. If necessary, VTS operator supports the supervisor in decision making in order to suspend the traffic. Taking all necessary measures concerning the vessels and scene, supervisor sent pilot, tugs and SAR boats, if necessary medical assistance, if necessary oil barriers and oil booms in coordination with related organizations, then sent an initial report to the related authorities. VTS operator fills up operator checklists and hands it over to supervisor. Some of the information to be filled in this checklist has already existed in the database. VTS operator gets rest of the information by asking additional questions to the vessels, of course, if it is possible. Supervisor is responsible to take all measures in accordance with the procedures. After operator's checklist, in the light of this information, a report is filled up and sent to the relevant parties, such as MRCC, Harbour Master, Coast Guard, Pilotage, Governorship, Health Control, Agent. VTS supervisor pursues all the developments of events, also gives support to Harbour Master in order to implement his decision and instruction. Getting information from related parties, VTS continue to take place in emergency plans. MRCC, Harbour Master or Governor play more important role in the emergency management and VTS assist them on their decision-making process. As conclusion of my presentation, I'd like to underline some key issues. Information sharing of port state controls between the related ports and countries is vital for the measures to be taken. Countries should provide the vessels in good condition as much as possible, which are under their flags. In addition, sending the pre-arrival information of the vessels to the necessary authorities timely and correctly is an important factor.